Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to thank you all for joining us today in our weekly webinar series. Today, our featured topic is DAS Basics and Certifying the Fiber Backbone. My name is Jessica Petrohoy, and I'm the Marketing Coordinator at FiberOptic.com. FiberOptic.com is a leading provider of fiber optic products, training, and rental equipment. And we're pleased to present this topic to you today. With us today to talk about DAS Basics is Jack Ianire. Jack is one of our senior instructors and a field technician with over 25 years in managing and testing networks. Jack will be discussing the different markets for DAS, IEEE standards, common DAS venues, and general installation topics. Remember that our webinar series are recorded and available to you online at fiberoptic.com/webinar. When Jack is finished, we'll take questions from the GoToWebinar question box at the bottom of your screen for a question and answer session. So at any time throughout the webinar, if you have a question, type it in and we'll get to it at the end. Thank you again for joining us today. And at this time, I turn the presentation over to Jack.
Well, good afternoon. I wanted to thank you for attending. And just a little background on me, I have been around a while, and my credentials run from BICSI as an RCDD and also as a technician. And wanted to get started today on this webinar to give you just a little peek into the world of DAS as we go down and explore this. You're going to find, there's my clicker. There we go. Well, what I've got up here is a overall view of a building DAS. So if we go down what we want to kind of cover today without going into too much depth, say in about 30 to 45 minutes, is we're going to touch on some of these key topics. And as you can see before you, we're going to give a short overview. We are going to talk about markets and public safety, a brief thing on doing site surveys and design, and other things that you would consider as you approach a DAS type of project, either if you're going to design one or if you're just participating as an installer in one or are an end user who might be inquiring about it also. Then we'll get into the basic parts, antennas, a little overview. We'll talk about active distribution and passive distribution and talk about analyzing the coverage and then finish up with some testing. Some on the RF side and a little bit on everyday fiber optic testing, which many of you may or may not be familiar with. So as we continue down, let's just do a basic definition. It's a deployment of various antenna configurations. And basically, it's extended coverage of wireless and mobile signals inside and outside a structure. So we're talking about, you know, privately owned structures or public if it's government buildings and stuff. Where historically we have poor cell service, or the RF signals do not reach into very well, or the density of the traffic is often irregular, erratic. So we're going to kind of focus on the indoor DAS applications. I will comment a little bit about outdoor as we cover in our fiber to the tower and antenna class also. But mainly today, we want to focus on this emerging DAS, which most of us think of on the commercial side as an in-building type of distribution antenna, with a little bit about wider area DAS, say, if you have an office park or a college campus. And then the system sizes range from very tiny, where you have a small office of a couple of floors, or to large scale using scale buildings and campuses, where you do use a base transceiver station. And that'll cover many areas of a building complex or campus environment. Now, if we get down to basics, there's two technologies that we're trying to support here. Historically, it may be providing your, I guess I'm going to use the word tenants or occupants, of data networks. That's typically our Ethernet covered in the IEEE 802.11. Now, we're also going to have to handle all types of devices so that we can interface or create a full menu of devices and systems that we can use on. Now, up here under the Ethernet, you've probably heard people talk about WiMAX and Bluetooth. But if you want to think about commercially, we typically run our buildings for our corporate with Ethernet networks. So our PCs are run. And then on the other side of the aisle, I might normally say, is a telecommunications network that you see from the big cell carriers. Now here we have a nice little diagram of the different, not different generations, but on the wireless. So we're really in a situation where if we're a private owner, we're trying to provide not just corporate services for voice, data, videos type of thing, but now we're also trying to have the tenant or occupant have a complete menu of services, not just for his corporate network, but that I can sit with my cell phone or my iPad and have full connectivity through the cellular type of network. So it's really a combination of quite a few worlds here we're going to be talking about. Now that brings us to, I mentioned Ethernet, which is a series of standards that pretty much have become the dominant force in networking and computers. And that's the IEEE 802.0 series. So I wanted to do just a quick rundown. It might be really old history, but some of the services we'll provide as far as Ethernet goes will range from the 802.11 standard, which specifies medium access and physical layer. So we can start cables. And it was basically designed for 1 megabit and 2 megabit wireless connectivity systems. And it was designed for between fixed, portable, moving stations within a local area. So we could have a phone and a large warehouse and I could get up and leave my desk and never lose my connectivity. 11A would transmit radio signals in the 5 gigahertz range with a bandwidth of about 54 megabits per second. Then we come to 11B, which is 2.4 gig range, running at about 11 megabits per second. And then 11G was a version that transmits 2.4 gigabits, bandwidth now up to 54 meg. 11N is one of the most common ones today, which is 2.4 or 5 gigabits, up to 245 megabit range. And 11Y transmit radio signals in the 3.7 gigahertz range, again, bandwidths at about 54 megabits per second. That gives you a rundown of the Ethernet standards that would be over wireless transmission of the broadband networks or the cellular networks. Now, in IEEE, 802.16 was you commonly see as WireMax. And if you can see the picture, it's where we all have access from our portable broadband devices, from our homes, from our businesses, that we have total connectivity within a certain metropolitan area. Now, we're not going to focus heavily on this today. So the original standards specified fixed point-to-point multi-broadband, as shown on this little drawing. I'm here, I'm connecting to the tower directly. Operates anywhere from 10 to 66 gigahertz spectrum. And 16A was a non-line of sight extension in the 2 to 11 hertz. Now here we can get about 70 megabits transmitting up to about 31 miles. So just some basic facts about some of the networks that we're going to be addressing. Now 802.15 you often hear is Bluetooth, which is a short range frequency at 2.4 gigahertz. And it can do both voice and data within about 32 feet. So that's often just a little portable ear sets and microphones that you may be attached to the cell phone that you may carry in your pocket. So it's good for about 32 feet. It's about a 1 megabit system, and it's 8 times any other wired speed, such as parallel and serial ports that have historically been used. Well, then we kind of jump to the other side of the aisle, because what we want to do is run all of our business systems and networks wirelessly and connect into the telecom networks. So shown here is just a little block diagram of a typical cell service where we have, you see them, the towers all over. My personal favorite tower is the Pine Tree Tower, which usually towers above the forest if they're trying to hide it. So our mobile wireless or cellular is set up where the towers are connected by some sort of backhaul, and today we'd like to talk about backhaul fiber back to the central office. and everything's tied together all the way take to the landline if you still have one at your home. So it's the mobile telephone system. So we're going to have to integrate in with that. That's the key to the DOS situation. Now below are some more common mobile wireless networks that you see deployed today. And this is everything from the 800 megahertz cellular up to the G4s, the G3s, the LTEs, all the various generations that have developed in the mobile or cellular market over the day. So DAS is designed to support these systems, and we'll be talking about it in an indoor environment. And the wireless backhaul antenna systems, which take us, say, from a rooftop antennas and connect onto the telecom networks you typically see here. Now, this is just a little thing about markets, and of course we know it's expanding just so rapidly. So this was a ABI research that the in-building wireless market goes to over $18 billion. And here it had stated, it's not a brand new, but in 2015, there were 5 billion wireless devices and 400 million of them were cellular. Now, it gives you the idea of the different systems on the telco. And here you see up by 2020, 5G and new wireless technologies. So you want to, as we look at design equipment that's going to handle state-of-the-art today that your provider can provide for you, whether it's a 4G or 5G or beyond that as they continue down. So where do we want to put them? Everywhere. You know, I attended a conference one time, and one of the big things was from, it sounded like a real estate guy. Real estate's all about location, location, location. And the same thing true as far as people visiting your facility or your employees. It's all about connectivity, connectivity, connectivity. And that can also help you keep employees. So whether you're in a hospital, a university, different high-rise, one of the hottest things now has been, you know, wiring all the arenas and stadiums and, you know, music event arenas so that all the people attending can stay connected and, you know, still watch their Star Wars while they're watching a baseball game. I don't know why they'd want to do that. But high-rise, hotels, so they're all markets. And it is also said that it's also part of keeping employees happy and even recruiting employees, because a person today is going to want to sit at his desk and obviously have all of his business that works, but he's not going to want to work for you if he can't get a cell phone signal or download his videos. We're not going to talk about security and preventing him from shopping while working, but they want the connectivity, and it becomes a big plus for companies and hiring practices. So the market's just about everywhere nowadays, and it has been one of the fastest growing segments of the fiber optic business or installation business. Now I'm going to talk lightly, just a couple of slides about public safety, because as we get into this, NAFA, National Fire Protection, in which the electric code comes out of, Article 70, has a public safety policy. So I could provide this service to the people in my building, but I may have some public safety issues. You know, the most common one was, how do I dial 911 and get connected the right way? And there are guidelines for that for your DAS system. Now, the second bullet I have up there is about, it's applicable if your municipality, the city, the state, whoever is in charge, if they adopt a code, then it would be enforceable for all existing and new buildings. And that's going to vary by your locale. And that really says that you're not just designing for connectivity of your people to the fun things that they can connect to, but you also have to have a procedure, and especially public arenas and such, to have the first responders use and, you know, people to contact, so whether it's your fire, your police. And it talks about retransmission agreements, and the public safety officials often will want permission before rebroadcasting. In other words, if they're going to broadcast any signals themselves in an emergency through your building, that they would want permissions to do so before they did it. and that could be set up well in advance. And then poor designs, as you lay out your building, your antennas and locations, that can harm coverage. In other words, if you don't address your coverage for this public safety issue, it could cause you exposure or liability exposure on it. So poor designs can create liabilities for you. So that's the one, public safety. Now here, attached to one of the head end devices or switches, is that a lot of the safety, you must provide 99% coverage in critical areas, including command centers, elevator lobbies, and exit stairs. Here you just see a particular manufacturer's product attached to one of the head end devices or switches. So it's in this manufacturer, it's in red. And this would give a critical central point for police to tie into and broadcast messages over your fire system, your safety system. And typically they might be enclosed in NEMA 4X, a little heavy duty enclosure. And all the repeater equipment would need to be FCC approved and certified. And they'll carry UPS, backup power supply requirements. So the primary is dedicated branch circuits, and the secondary would be at least a 12-hour backup in most locales. And along with that safety thing would come along annual testing and requirements by whoever your inspection agency is, or fire departments and police departments. So a little bit of word in design, especially that it is important that you have some sort of public safety brought into any design or into your system. Now, site surveys, we'll talk a little bit. Looks like a lot here, but you need to measure signal strength. I'm sitting at a place right here where I've got three bars on my AT&T and the towers across the street. But if I go into the main office, I dropped it like one over in our training room here in Briningsville. But you need to measure what type of signals that you are getting. And it may give you an idea of what vendor you want to pick to provide the signal. I could have a very poor AT&T, but another vendor might in fact be a much better power source in here. It goes on to say you want to look at spectrum snapshots, potential interference, noise floor, take your in-building transmitter test, which is, again, analyzing your radio frequencies environment, path losses, and other spectrum analyzing. We'll show a little bit of a chart on that, but not a lot today. Then you go installation considerations, taking pictures, document, plan. You would note any concerns, and that could be physical building constructions that might interfere with what you want to do or might really determine how you're going to do it. So different installation considerations. Now, for those users in the construction business, you know, this is a typical site survey as to who, what, where, when, why, when, and now what am I going to do type of questions that you need to answer before you start buying equipment and building. And that's really the importance of any site survey. Document your code, safety requirements, your local jurisdiction having authority, inspectors, agencies, and you pick out and start gathering the information at this stage. And you're looking for places where I can put my equipment, my head ends, for instance. Any unique considerations, anything from, gee, this old theater obviously has historic protection and there are certain things you can't do. I can't drill holes all over the place. And I'm sure you've run into certain things before. And then there are critical path issues. Well, whatever media I intend to run, do I have shielded or fortified rooms? And of course, I mentioned here a hospital. You know, how do I run into a lead sheave, some sort of MRI x-ray room, you know, without violating the path? So you're going to have to consider that. Other things are existing, intermediate distribution frames or where the telco closets are or where you might have to do new, where you're going to have to do things like roof penetrations and the coverage antenna. Can be mounted in the ceilings, and are there clear cable paths? Since this is usually an add-on, you know, are the trays and conduits and pathways open, or in fact, do you have to build new ones? if you continue, and you probably can't, this is kind of a tip, maybe it'll look at this, but this is kind of a generic site survey checklist. You know, if you want to take a look at what the roof material is, I'm just picking out a couple. This is just a generic construction. Utility access, you know, what your service would be, amperage ratings. You can kind of look over that. But you're looking for, you know, your floors, your square footage, because that's antenna coverage is obviously going to be determined by physical placement and based upon square footage. What service providers do you have? You may only have one in your area, and that may answer that question quite easy. Other environments, you know, is your building really dense or is it a very open type of architecture? The floor plans themselves, and a look at your interior walling, because it will affect the penetration of RF waves and even wireless Ethernet waves on our standard wireless network. How strong is your signal standing on the roof? And phones and spectrum analyzer readings. As I said, we're not going to have time today to go in depth like we would in a full class. But obviously, you want to know, well, do I have an existing RF system? And how about the roof mount area? Now, they can be mounted or just weighted down on the roof. And where would I put my head-end equipment so that I have the easiest routing paths of cable? And what is existing power and wall space? Now, these are the classic telecom closet, equipment room, or small data center questions where you have distribution frames, intermediate, and the main. Then the type of cable. You know, if I'm going to be running through, say, an office building, am I going to have the cable, either fiber optic or even in some cases twisted pair category rated cable, of a fire rating, such as we conveniently, commonly known as plenum cable. And then other obstacles, stairs, elevators, which tend to shield areas. You know, what are the interior walls made of? Ceiling heights, drop tiles. What is the purpose of the, you know, what do we use this building for? Denser open environments was kind of brought up before. And the vertical chase, as we talked about pathways, horizontal where you have trays, or what is the vertical pathways up the many floors of a building? I do want to draw your attention to a typical loss chart. Now, some of our signals can penetrate. Some signals simply bounce off. A lot are line of sight, so how do I get signals around walls and coverage? But just to give you an idea, in this little chart called cover, that typically, depending on the broadcast frequency, and here we go up to 5.8 gigahertz, that typically drywall would contribute about a 3 dB typical losses through the drywall. And you see we go glass, no shielding, but for the most part, on whatever system, that you're running roughly 2 to 3 losses through the building materials. Now, I like to point out that last one, lead. Notice not much penetrates the lead. Well, where are you going to find that today? And that's typically might be in a hospital where they have a lot of medical equipment and are shielding heavily, you know, the MRI rooms or the old X-ray rooms. So I hope that gives you an idea of things that you need to consider. Now, as far as design, it obviously begins with a site survey. Even if you hire an outside contractor or engineer to do this, the first thing you take a look at the site, which we've already discussed, and then determine the configurations of your system. And then you have kind of an analysis, another survey with signal strengths and all. And that determines the configuration, ultimately, of your antenna systems. And then how you are going to construct, and accept, and implement. Some pretty basic design steps. Here's IBWave, which is a software provider. And there are many competitors on it. But it predicts wireless coverages for all the technologies, the Gs. For a variety of, and with it, you can produce design drawings, heat maps, develop bills of materials, and actually be part of your design package where you would end up with a scope of work, a specific bill of material, publisher link budgets, and end up with a set of design and, in this case, result in a build drawing of software design. There are many other people that do it. I just wanted to give you an overview. Now, the frequency bands usually are designed around the public wireless providers. Here we have AT&T, Verizon, Nextel, and public safety usually varies, but it's around 800 megahertz systems. So you can get an idea what the different vendors that you may be dealing with. And we did just mention a little while ago, you know, you may want to do AT&T, but, you know, T-Mobile's got the strongest signal right outside your front door. So that would impact some of your design. Now, your wireless thresholds, just to give you an idea, an in-building DAS operates on relatively low power, and there are some issues with amplifier powers coming in, where the cell towers are fairly high powered and the indoors fairly low powered devices. So here we go. We can go down as low as negative 85 for the radio signal, over 90% of the coverage areas. So the higher the level is required to overcome outside influences, but negative 85 dBm. That means a typical radius for an antenna coverage can go from 50 feet in very dense requirements to 100 feet in open requirements. So hopefully you can start to draw, and I will put a drawing up in your mind that, you know, I've got a lot of open areas. I'm going to get a lot more coverage out of a particular antenna than I have a lot of cubicles and cut up office spaces. And 1900 megahertz is a limiting factor if you're doing Wi-Fi or AWS, which you wouldn't have in others. Now, what do I need to address in a design? So it begins with a needs analysis and a process to determine the configuration of your DAS. And you could simply just put them in four. There are things I'm going to do pre-construction or pre-installation you see there, which means it's the site survey, the needs analysis, you know, map out the signal strength. And then I would proceed to some sort of installation, acceptance, and implementation on the design side. So, outdoor coverages for campus, parks, and cities are kind of where you want clients to have access to LAN or Wi-Fi hotspots, that they'll need an antenna distribution system that would cover those locations. So you need to know, well, how am I going to mount the antennas, what type of combination of building and towers may be used, and that'll help me decide where I'm going to place the antennas for the best coverage. The active and passive equipment doesn't change. It's the antenna system that extends the service from your building to the coverage. And here you see here a campus where we have one floor here without walls, where you can see the tie-in from the cellular access to a head end, where I have a feed going up the floors of the building and then come in with a fiber link to a couple different buildings to feed them, just to give you a quick overview. Now, the backhaul antenna systems, and it could deploy line of sight in different configurations that'll extend the coverage. And again, on this chart here, you can see a pretty good line where I have an in-building DAS with an antennas on each floor, which go back through the backhaul network. I also have an outdoor DAS. And then on a baseband unit towards the tower, the BBU, or on a rooftop, is connected to remote head-end. And then coming the other side, I also could have a base station connected by way of a coax cable. So we're always going to get a combination of media, copper, fiber, and locations in what we call the backhaul. Now, they are point to point. They can be point to multipoint, and over long distances will support your cellular, your commercial carriers, and any licensed or unlicensed wireless systems you have. The size of the system typically varies with the type of the system being deployed. Now, one other thing is about power Now, this is pretty basic. If any of you are already installers or technicians, you've probably seen this, and in fact, this one is right out of our chart, where we want to give an idea of a link budget. Well, basic link budgets are predicated upon two things. The power output of your amplifier, transmitter, and the sensitivity of your receiver. And of course, they would be connected together. So the first chart you see is right out of one of our classes, is that how would I calculate the power output of the transmitter and receiver? Well, you see, it's a classic old, the average transmitter power minus the sensitivity receiver equals the total link budget loss. Now, an example I have up there, it's at one of our other classes. The net total link loss budget is 7.6 dB. Now, that simply means that if my physical plant, whether it be wireless, fiber, or copper, where I have a transmitter connected to a distant receiver, in this particular math, it says simply that if my cable plant, let's use that term today, uses more than 7.8 dB, eats up, and this is electric or light, so it doesn't change, then that simply means your receiver will not have a signal to receive, so your system won't work. So that's what I meant by power output or keys to a link budget. First, it starts with the transmitter receiver. And then rather than in most fiber optic runs, whether it be our backhaul where we have a physical cable, which by specification we know how much a kilometer that cable is going to lose is light, when you're getting into the wireless world, and we will have wireless devices connected with the same cables, notice I brought back in my typical loss clutter calculations, because we are on the wireless networks would also have to budget in these factors, just like we would on the physical parts of the hardwired cable plant, fiber plus the connectors plus splitters, whatever devices you physically have in the past. Now this will help you in any type of design. And then finally somebody comes out with a revised design which is generated and recommended as the final design or build. Okay, so design and build drawings if you want to use. Now again, in some of the classes we go a lot deeper in this. So what do I need to answer about in the buildings? Well, who's going to be the WSP, or it's another acronym, because there's often, you know, you'd say, gee, what's our problem here? Well, I always have one bar, and that's probably about 90% of everybody's problem. So those are less than 3 bars on the phone. Now, you know, are your people, tenants, visitors complaining about poor cellular coverage? Or do you see half your employees hang out on the outside perimeter next to the window to use their phones? And to what degree does the owner of the building want to provide these services? And finally, the public safety comment, which we kind of went through before. Now, as far as passive, well, we can elect to use either active devices, which are obviously going to be more expensive, or traditionally some of these passive devices, which is I can use a coaxial cable to distribute my RF signals, which would cut down on the number of electronics, transmitters, and receivers I would need. And they're great for small locations, but maybe limited growth potential for most of the buildings we have. Would I carry parallel systems separate from the carrier, provide service, and a separate one for public safety? Now, if I want to go fiber, which tends to be what we're doing today, then active devices come into play, which means I need a transmitter talking to a distant receiver over a medium, let's say, fiber optic cable. It's scalable, single to multi-band. It's flexible, cost-effective. Expandable, and you can combine one system for more for both the carrier sections, meaning your actual commercial signal and public safety can all run over the same system, as that little public safety module you saw sitting up on top of a transmitter receiver earlier. Now, when we get into antennas, so we want to have efficient use of available frequency spectrum. We want to easily expand. And in the backhaul antenna systems, we often want to support voice data and videos across vast difference. So what's the purpose? Well, a device to transmit or receive. They must be tuned or matched the same frequency as the radio system where your transmission is going to be paired. We often use omnidirectional antennas in the center of a large area because they can provide 360-degree coverage pattern. Some parameters when selecting. Where am I going to put it? What's the operating distance and transmitter? Other desired qualities. Small size versus big size. Good gain characteristics. And omni or directional. And how do they look? Well, here's just a few typical omnidirection antennas. So they can be omnidirectional, and leaky coax is still a way. And many times our system may be a combination of different antennas along with leaky coax and, of course, fiber for some. But they can broadcast in some of the terms you see there. In the directional category, so you can see here in the directional, these are antennas that obviously are aimed in a particular direction. So they would have to be based on where you want to shoot into an area so they can pick up. And here you just see some typical examples of antennas you'll see on buildings or on towers throughout the country. Directional. Now the leaky coax says what's a, you know, a long cable running through your building carrying signals can radiate and or receive signals. So it's a big antenna. It can carry the RF signal and can pick up leak. Basically, it doesn't show a good picture here, but the shields are slotted so that they effectively can pick up signals and radiate out signals. Now, full coverage coax with the shielding like that, its purpose is that no signal leaks out of the coax and no unwanted signal leaks into the coax. So this is the reverse of that. If I open this up a little bit, it's pretty well shielded, but signals can come in and signals can come out. Often leaky coax is used with a DAS. Often leaky coax is used in, well, one of the first places I ran into it in this area at Western Pennsylvania is, in fact, the mining industry uses a lot of leaky coax. Roof mount, so I can bolt it down, I can get flexible, I can just, oh, you'll often see examples of a pedestal like the one on the left where the guy's got sandbags piling on to keep it from blowing off the roof. That would depend upon where you live, I'm sure. And then as we get into the active equipment, and you see here, so it's a primary head-end device. That's what the cable TV or the broadcaster or cellular calls the main equipment room, the head-end equipment. Here you see a little better. It's a cutout of one of the earlier drawings where we can communicate by phone or radio. The antennas pick up, comes to the head-end equipment room, and the cell signal source is on the right side here, and we have coax going up the building, and then you can see the bidirectional amplifiers or repeaters and the fiber distribution head-end equipment. That'll give you a picture. The back-end equipment transmit and receive signals from the head end to the antennas within the DAS in your building. And it's most commonly the same make and manufacture as the head-end equipment. Open standards, and this is a key bullet, this last one, open standards tend to not exist. So often matching manufacturer's product is probably going to be part of your considerations. Until such time, if you come from the IT world or indoor building networking, we get so used to interoperability, you know, everybody's router works with everybody else's. Not exactly true here, although it is improving. You're probably going to have to match the manufacturer of the active devices. And it's, again, connected at a head end by way of the backbone and then to the antennas. So at this point, I think he kind of got the idea. Now, I thought these couple slides, on any of these presentations, it probably boils down to about five things you want to leave. And I'd like to give you understand that, you know, the received signals, whether you're really going to run on a coax or over a fiber ultimately, but your received signals are measured in power, decibel milliwatts. So a typical threshold for our devices would be as low as negative 85 dBm. The lower the signal, and it's basically a signal noise ratio for the server. So a noisy room, for example, might need, but you want to look at that number. If you fall below signals weaker than about 85, then you may have some problems with signals picking up. So that's one of the importance of measuring the received signal strength. And wanted to get in on the higher end, just give you a quick overview of the way that I can measure, record, document. And usually by that time, it's not, you know, we're in the fiber world, we're so familiar with OTDRs and power meters, and we use them here. But on the RF side is that you do have devices, this one is particularly the Agilent, which will measure the different types of phones, so you can actually record your signal strength and map it out. Now here's a typical room where if I have a negative 85 is a typical threshold. And here you can see, and I think this was a convention center for a hotel where these were meeting rooms, you can see all red is that I am less than 95, which means I have weak signals. If you pull up here to the yellows, now I'm greater than 85. So the lower the number, so negative 70 is much more power than negative 85. So you're better off. It's the old 3 dB rule of power. And then here is, this originally was a parking deck, but same issues. This is what you map at. Look, the green ones, I'm good to go. The red ones, maybe I can live with. The yellow, it's starting to get, yellow I might be able to live with, and then finally red comes in. Just a quick picture to give you an idea when we're talking about coverage. Now testing, different test methods, and I just showed you a way to test the power signal levels, you know, whether they be conventional RF signals or even power levels for fiber optics. But it's a complex. And if you're not testing, validating, and planning for it, then the worst case is you put all the money into it and it doesn't work very well. So some challenges. Has the coax fiber been installed correctly? Now, if you've been in the business, you've gone through that issue on every system we have. The physical plant is the same thing for testing as you might be familiar with, whether you are a cell tower guy or a outside plant long haul guy, or customer owned outside plant, you know, the backbone's pretty much all the same when it comes to fiber and testing and what the components are. Which means is your media connected properly? Are the losses through different things like connectors within specs? In addition to our RF issues, you know, is there any source of interference within our area? It may look like I could do this, and you may have an industrial complex or a an AM transmitting tower nearby that may, in fact, not give you the best performance, even if you build it. So you need to look at that before you build it. And then we can encompass in one signal just about everything you can think of in cable TV, the antenna stuff, or internet. And what does that mean? We got fiber cables, we got copper cables, in this case coax RF cables. We can split passive optical networks like the fiber to the home. And so we can split the RF signal, we can split the fiber signal, and then we're going to have amplifiers. So the obvious is that there's no one simple system, that each one's built to the building that you have in mind. But we're going to go over various types and finish this up, that it can be tested and troubleshot, that doesn't sound like a good word, but troubleshot, just by the old method of breaking things down. Now, during a construction phase, you know, if you're a fiber contractor, you may or may not have run across some of these instruments because you may just be testing the cable plant. But we need to also test the cable plant, not just for specifications and laws, but for actual network performance capability. So we can certify fiber connectors with things like the familiar OTDR. But we're going to have some equipment that's going to be coaxial based for the return loss on the RF systems. and there are some antennas and equipment that we will use, typically conventional Category 6 UTP type of cable. Well, below are a couple of product lines here that we would use to cover whatever we needed to test. Here we come in again. So I can connect connectors using a digital probe microscope, which you see with the smart class tester with a scope. Optical insertion loss can be performed by any number of these machines, including the Certifier 40G can do both copper and a fiber. And then specifically, it can also do coax, and they do have a little larger based analyzer called the Cell Advisor. And but for twisted pair, I can use what they call the Certifier 40G, and many of you may already own various UTP certifiers. Now, Vavi, one of the, I guess, new named us here, but not a new name, does have for RF testing equipment and ones that can also test the fiber. Another name is Iran Advisor TrueSight, which is their version, provides service testing and positioning. And then finally, a backhaul, which is basically the cable test, which uses a T-bird in their nomenclature, which is OTDR. There's a little clearer picture of the particular devices. And then the RAN advisor, missing or faulty as well as walk. So this is the thing that's going to draw you the picture. These are the higher level than straight, say, backbone or cable testing. Now, on an everyday real world level, this is the 8 steps to a good system. And this is really physically about fiber optics, 1 through 8. Well, let's go through them real quick and we'll wrap it up there. Well, 1, shouldn't be news. And the number gets higher every time I look at a bullet. This one says 75% of all network problems are issues due to dirty or damaged connectors. So the biggest problem with fibers is dirt in our connector interfaces. I can use a video inspection scope. Here you see one in the middle on an OTDR where you can see the end face and compare it to the IEC specifications. So these little microscopes are great to inspect and then clean before you put into service connectors, patch cords, any equipment type of ports. That takes care of 75%. Boy, that is better odds than any casino around here is going to give you. Next is just simple continuity. I put the light in A, does it come out on B? They can be typically done with many of our equipment, but on a low cost end, a inexpensive visual fault locator can also red light in, red light out, and can be several miles away. Simple continuity. End of span total loss, A to B. Couple things we can do. Power meter and light source gives us the overall link loss. An OTDR also can give us the overall loss at a much greater price and less accuracy as far as overall loss. Now, I showed you here one of the setups from JDSU. And the big thing, although not new if you're a cell tower guy, is this loopback testing. That means I can go to a remote device or I can send somebody up a tower and loop back, and I can shoot up, loop back to the receive, that guy standing on the ground. And it'll take an average bidirectional, basically a push of the button, of your loop up, back, divided by half, and that's the average loss. Okay, I put that picture in, it's out of the antenna course or the tower course, because they commonly use that. So I now see a lot of notes coming out saying about loopback. Well, if you're a floor certifier in some of the premise, a lot of the certification testers for fiber are loopbacks, where they shoot out on one and come back on the receive. Same concept here would be lent to the DAS type of setups. The individual splice losses. What I want to point out here, because splices are fusion splices, permanent, and they should be measured, and typically they're going to be 0.01 to 0.1 is the IEEE max, Although if you're fusion splices, you know, you'd never accept a 0.1. You're going to be down maybe no more than 0.03. But it's a small drop on a trace. A macro bend may appear as a splice. Now, all that means is this signature that indicates a splice would be the same signature as somebody bent your cable too tight. So if you had a OTDR produce this signature at a footage marker in which there were no splices, it would indicate that at that particular point you have a bend. Did I go? Wrong. There it goes. Then connectors themselves. Typical, I think the TIA says 0.75 mated pair. Here is a shown on an OTDR graph. The fact is today's connectors, I wouldn't accept 0.75. The little LC connectors you use typically should be like 0.2 or 0.3. The SC, the larger scale, would be at about 0.5 dB at the most. And it's shown as a spike of the back reflection to a drop. And then number six is back reflectance. And all the little chart in front of you shows we now polish the connectors and that to cut down back reflections, which on high-powered laser systems can damage the amplifiers if too much of the outbound signal is returned back to the source. So a small negative number, larger reflections. A large negative number means there's less going back towards the amplifier. These are the polish of the connector tips you hear about. And they can range from physical contact or flat, we'd call about 30 dB negative, all the way up to the angle polished green connectors you might find in a Fios type of setup, which has negative 65 to 70, which is almost lossless as far, or almost no back reflection at all as far as the system's concerned. So if you open up a fiber to the home box, you're probably going to see the angle polish, or certainly at least a UPC. So to give you an idea, since it's negative, the larger the number, the less back reflectance. All can be read with an OTDR. Now here I said a macro bend, or a bend in your cable, looks like a fusion splice. And it is troubleshooted by shooting the different wavelengths. Because the splice is not wavelength dependent, the loss on an actual fusion splice. So if I shot it at 1310 and then 1550, it's going to be the same loss. But you'll notice here, light traveling through the glass, that if it is bent too tight, you see a lot bigger losses occur at longer wavelengths. So light traveling through glass is wavelength sensitive. And the longer the wavelength, the more likelihood I'm going to get losses due to macro bends or bends. And this little chart's a pretty good picture. So if 1310 is blue and 1625 in red, you can say that each successive sweep, higher frequency sweep, the drop gets worse. There's your signature four. And in order to accurately in these systems determine macro bands, you really need to shoot all the wavelengths, because only by comparing them can you tell that there is. And then the summation of all reflected signals back to the transmitter. And so the sum of all losses from light traveling in glass and light going through fusion splices, which don't have back reflections, but certainly connector. And about 30 dB is often specified as a system pass-fail. Actually be a negative 30. The sum of all back reflections. Now questions, and I guess the only one I have, do you consider DAS in a rainy area? And I'd have to say I would. It is radio signals. You shouldn't have particular problem with it. Now, I'm not sure you're a rainy area. There are some things like with fiber optic, free space fiber optics, where you have a laser beam is somewhat affected by it. But your RF signals on the ground would be less affected by it as just rain. I'm not going to address lightning storms and stuff like that. But I would be less concerned in a rainy area with a cell tower system, because they're operable all over the U.S. and in Florida, which is pretty rainy situations. And you should be okay with that. That was one of the questions we had up. And then I had the other question. We had a couple. Okay, this is a trick question. CPRI, that may be new, but it's Common Public Radio Interface. Well, earlier I said that the head end equipment and all the equipment is probably going to have to be one manufacturer, and that may have to be the manufacturer what your cell tower or service provider has, because there's not much of an interface or standardization above it. Now, CPRI is that they are working steadily to a common public radio interface, so that you necessarily have to have the same equipment on all of your repeaters. And how do we decide what kind of network to install? That has to go back to the client on what services you are providing, either both for your employees or for visitors and other clients on the site. You just have to decide. And you can assume everybody wants cell phone signal, but everybody probably wants the Ethernet and surf the net too. So that question kind of can answer itself. And can a DAS be constructed to support multiple wireless carriers? Yes, but you may have equipment for each one of them as part of your head-end equipment. So that can be interfaced, but it's probably going to cost you a little more money. And then finally, the last one I had was, won't systems be obsolete in a few years? And they're going to say, yes, I hope so. It kind of fuels our industry. So with that, I'll kind of take off. But your system's probably going to be good, as most IT systems, for somewhere between 7 and 10 years. There's going to be a new technology next week, and you'll have to decide whether to adapt to it. But remember, these are relatively scalable. So when we get to 6G, I guess we just have to go buy a new card for our equipment or a new piece of equipment and slap it in. Well, with that, and I don't seem to have any other questions, I think we can sign off. So I bid you all a good day, and I hope it was informative and perhaps encourage you to look into maybe one of our DAS classes, and hope to see you all in the future. Thank you for participating, and have a good evening. Bye-bye.